Dallas Theological Seminary's Chapel Podcast.
As you know him, he's our chancellor. He's the pastor of Stonebriar. He's the voice of Insight for Living. He's the author of so many books that have changed so many of our lives. But his friendship and his encouragement in the ministry here to all of us on our faculty and our administration and you as students, I know deeply appreciate it. He will be speaking at our commencement chapel next week, and then he will be out of town because his granddaughter graduates from Wheaton this year. But in this last chapel of this semester that he will be with us, would you join me in welcoming Dr. Charles Swindoll as our speaker?
Congratulations, Dr. Pentecost, on your 95th birthday. That's wonderful. And to know that Mark Bailey ran into my sister gives me pause, not knowing what in the world she told him. But she's the one who taught me how to smoke. And so, among other things, which is a story unto itself. That experience kept me from ever smoking again, but that... It's hard to find people who will talk straight with us, people who will remove all the varnish, all the nonsense, all the, we say in Texas, all the smoke blowing, and say it straight. Every once in a while, we run across a person like that, and we're grateful for them, usually, but not always. This past weekend, while I was away, I read the story of a Mississippi grandma who was in that stripe. She talked the truth, whether you wanted to hear it or not. She happened to be on the stand at a particular trial in the Deep South, and defense attorney stood before her and said, "Mrs. Jones, do you know me?" She replied, "Well, yeah, I know you, Mr. Williams. I've known you since you were a little boy. Frankly, you've been a big disappointment to me." "You lie, you cheat on your wife, and you manipulate people, and you talk about them behind their backs. You think you're a big shot when you haven't the brains to realize you'll never amount to anything more than a two-bit paper pusher. Yeah, I know you." The lawyer was stunned. Not knowing what else to do, he pointed across the room and he asked, "Ms. Jones, do you know the prosecuting attorney?" She replied, "Yeah, I know him too. Mr. Bradley and I have been friends for a long time, since he was a youngster. Bradley's lazy, bigoted, has a drinking problem. He can't build normal relationships with anyone, and his law practice is one of the worst in the entire state. Not to mention, he cheated on his wife with three different women. One of them is your wife." "Yeah, I know Bradley." The prosecuting attorney nearly passed out. The judge asked both counselors to approach the bench in a very quiet voice, said, "If either of you idiots ask her if she knows me, I'm sending you to the electric chair." Long live Grandma Jones. Many years ago, at a particular time in my life, I asked the Lord to give me the guts to speak the truth and to talk straight, and to help me forget who was in the congregation or the audience, but simply to talk straight about whatever may be the issue. It's not my desire to offend, but if the truth offends, so be it. I've asked the Lord not to let me stay awake at night worrying about what other people may think or say. You know, age helps. It does. It helped Ms. Jones, and it has helped me. And I happen to have been married to marry a wife like that. Like the other day, while I was away on this weekend conference, I finished my first talk, which really didn't fly very well. And just before we went to sleep, she said to me, "That might be one of those talks you put on the bottom of the stack, honey." She was right. I want to talk to you today, and I want to talk straight about ministry success. And I have in mind especially early success. Because unfortunately, some of you are bound for early success in your ministry. I say unfortunately because you won't be ready for it. There's nothing wrong with success. God lifts up one and puts down another. It's His call. Every once in a while, I feel chagrin when I hear about a young man or woman who has experienced early ministry success. I thought of it this past weekend while watching the NFL draft. And I thought how many of those young men, just magnificent athletes, are about to enter the most perilous time of their lives. Suddenly, they go from the life of a virtual pauper as a college student, coming from a background where they had nothing, and they will sign on for millions, multiple millions of dollars. Some of them already wearing big, fat gold watches and heavy gold chains around their neck. And I'm thinking, oh, Lord, help them. Help some counselor, some friend, some mama to come alongside and talk straight with them about what they've got in front of them. Now, I say there's nothing wrong with it because in the Bible, occasionally the Lord gave early success. It was on the heels of David's defeating the giant Goliath that the people sang his song and followed him. And we read even in the 18th chapter of 1 Samuel that the Lord was with him. The Lord was with him. The Lord blessed him. The Lord honored him, even though he's young. I mean, think of it. He's hardly in his 20s. And he's already eminently successful in the eyes of the people. And he's hardly been tried. That would come shortly thereafter. Then I thought of Joseph, right after he interpreted Pharaoh's dream. I mean, it was like a meteor across the sky. Before you knew it, Pharaoh has given him the topmost position in the nation, just below that of Pharaoh, put him in charge of the treasury of the house of Pharaoh. We read in Genesis 41. Read it. I mean, it's incredible how he is catapulted into this early success, and he handled it beautifully. Even the presence of his brothers who came with their hat in their hand thinking he was going to retaliate. Uzziah is 16 and he becomes the king. Josiah is half that age and he became the king. Think of that. Here these boys are, the king of the nation, early successful. So there is nothing innately wrong with it. It's just perilous. You who are magnificently gifted, you who have such intellects and ability early on in your life on your feet to preach, and others of you to counsel, to lead organizations. Perhaps before you turn 35, you're going to be in a place where people will be hanging on your words, and people in the organization will be looking to you for creative leadership, and you can do it. You can do it. There's no question. You've got training here, and you've got a background in your field, perhaps, and you've had models before you, and before you know it, you move into a realm of perilous success. It's what J. Oswald Sanders calls the peculiar perils of leadership. Among them in that chapter in the book Spiritual Leadership, pride, egotism, jealousy, popularity, envy, elation and depression, indispensability, infallibility. All of these are traps that await you as a young, successful minister. Whether missionary on some distant field or pastor of a church that you become before long known in the community. We're not paid in money like the professional athletes, but we're paid with influence. Knowing that our words are listened to and they're making an impact in the lives of those that come, and maybe the crowds will grow. And it happened to Spurgeon. Success exposes a man to the pressure of people and thus tempts him to hold on to his gains by means of fleshly methods and practices, and to let himself be ruled wholly by the dictatorial demands of incessant expansion. On and on he goes. I fear for you. I want God's best for you, and I'm here to talk straight about these things. And thankfully, I have the model in front of me on the pages of Mark chapter 1, the perfect model of one who handled it flawlessly, Jesus of Nazareth. And so I want to talk to you about how to counteract these things that Sanders mentions in his book and other things that may come to our mind this morning. Jesus comes from Nazareth, and before John knows it, he is baptizing him, and he comes up out of the water, and the Spirit of God, like a dove, descends and endorses the life and the ministry of this 30-year-old itinerant evangelist who was in Galilee. And after 40 days in temptation, he's back on the scene, and before you know it, he's ministering in Capernaum, and already the crowds are growing. And I'm preaching through Mark at our church, and while going through this first chapter, I was taken by how often I would read words like, they were amazed, they were astonished, they were amazed. Read the end of the Sermon on the Mount, nobody moves. The end of chapter 7 of Matthew, when they've never heard anyone like him. They've been sitting through all those tedious, boring talks of scribes, and they hear this magnificent messenger filled with the Spirit and the authority of God, delivering his soul to the people from the scrolls of the Scriptures, and they are absolutely stunned. Verse 21, they went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath he entered the synagogue and began to teach. They were amazed at his teaching. He's a guest speaker at the synagogue, which is not uncommon, and he stands to deliver, and they notice immediately how young he is, but with what ability to handle the text of the scriptures, and he does that with a remarkable skill, so much so that they're amazed. Look at what it says in 22. They're amazed at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one having authority, not as the scribes. It isn't pride. It isn't egotism. It's a God-inspiring authority that would make you want to stand up in his presence. I was with men like that over the weekend, and men and women alike, they didn't happen to be wearing their uniforms, but they are 3- and 4-star admirals and generals. And some of them just made the rank of brigadier general. And you couldn't tell what their rank was because they were dressed in civilian clothes. But I could tell being with them how they conducted themselves with this sense of confidence. They have commanded troops in battle. They have dealt with the dying. They've led them through difficult and dangerous places. They've all carried heavy weapons. They've made strategic decisions. And now they sit in rooms without windows, those in the Joint Chiefs. And they are making plans for war and dealing with terrorism. We can't even imagine what that is like in our world. And when you're with these people on a weekend like we had together, you if you're smart, you sit with your mouth shut and you listen and you watch. That's what these people are doing as Jesus is in the synagogue with them. Verse 22, they're amazed at his teaching, for he taught as one having authority. And then out of the blue, there's the shriek of a demon using the vocal cords of a man in the synagogue. And this is all coming. We read of it here in a calm manner, but it's interrupting the message. If you've ever preached and had your message interrupted, you know what a shock it can be at the moment. I've had it happen several times. You don't quite know what to do or how to handle it. Jesus is not at all taken aback. In fact, you read in the way Mark writes it, just then, verse 23, just then, there was a man in their synagogue with an unclean spirit, and he cried out. It is a word for a shriek, a scream. The truth has been declared, and demons despise it and often can't remain quiet. And out comes the scream. What business do we have to do with each other, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. And Jesus, without a hitch, rebuked him. He rebukes the spirit, saying, be quiet. The word means to muzzle. Shut up and come out. That is authority. Dealing with this supernatural being stands Jesus, who rebukes him and says, be quiet, and throwing him into a convulsion. You ever seen that? I've seen it. I've seen it abroad, and I've seen it in the States. It's an ugly, ugly, horrifying scene. We deal with it in a sort of antiseptic manner as we go through our studies here at the seminary. But when you are there, it puts a chill up your back. You're watching things that you've never experienced before. And the convulsion is wild and violent as this demon is being pulled from this victim and again cries out with a loud voice, and he came out of him. Of course he did. God commanded him to. Greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world. These people, can you imagine these dear people in the synagogue? I mean, they have never seen like this in their life. They've been fighting to stay awake through the scribes' tedious talks. And all of a sudden, they've got this preacher that has them spellbound with his ability in the truth. And now he's commanding a demon right in their presence. And they look again, verse 27. They were all amazed that they debated among themselves, saying, what is this? What is this? What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits and they obey him. Mark returns to his favorite word. Immediately the news about him spread everywhere. Look at this, unto all the surrounding district of Galilee. He's a 30-year-old preacher. I fully acknowledge, of course, he is the Son of God, but he's a 30-year-old man. And this is the early part of his ministry, and it could happen to any one of you. This kind of growth didn't happen until I was about midway through into my ministry. And I was called to a church, and it was just at the right place and the right time and the right gifts and the right needs and the pieces of the puzzle fell together. Nobody could have predicted it. And we blinked, and we had doubled in size, and we blinked, and another doubling in size, and it's like, what on earth? And this sort of sleepy little community had come alive. It was not because of me. The truth of God took hold, and it was at a time when the hunger level was just off the chart. And the Jesus people stumbling along the beaches of Southern California, trying to find themselves, and suddenly the word began to spread and God began to do a work. And I'll tell you the truth. I absolutely did not know what to do. I'd never known anything like it in my life. Neither did the elders know what to do. We didn't have any money. Here we were packed out. We went to 5 services and on I could tell you, 6, I forget, 7 maybe, closed circuit TV rooms. We had to buy land. God provided the money for that, paid cash for the land, built a building, and ultimately paid that off. And it was just remarkable. And we were all, I mean that, all amazed. I was so grateful that I was by then in my 40s and wasn't in my 20s. I was grateful I had 4 very honest kids and a very honest wife who became increasingly more honest as growth happens. It was very helpful. It just anchored me to reality. And it's essential. I pray to God that you have a spouse like that and that you'll listen to that spouse through whom the Lord will often speak. Now, we're talking about counteracting this expansion, this growth, this success. And I want you to see an example. 29, immediately after they came out of the synagogue, they came into the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was lying sick with a fever, and immediately they spoke to Jesus about her. I mean, they had seen what he did with the demons, and they thought, oh, maybe he can help here. I mean, they've never read Mark 1, so they don't know what's coming. And they got mother-in-law sick and probably all hungry after this church service, look at how sweet this is. He came to her and he raised her up, taking her by the hand, and the fever left her and she waited on him. Let me say first, it was out of compassion that he brought healing. There's not a word of irritation. Don't you guys realize I've been pouring my heart out, I've been casting out demons, I've been preaching. I mean, couldn't one of the others of you help out? There was none of that. There was no irritation. It was instant compassion. And it wasn't a big crowd. It was one very, very sick mother. Luke uses a word, seized with a high fever. So this lady's sick. And Jesus walks in one-on-one, and he takes her by the hand, and he heals her. I love the way that this miracle is performed. You always know it's a miracle from God when it is immediate and permanent. There's no promise. There's no exchange of money. There's no healing line. There's no showmanship. There's just the word or just the touch, and the fever's gone. Prompted from a heart of compassion. Let me tell you, when you are in a ministry of success, don't leave out compassion. Stay near it. Stay near the hurting. Keep a quiet ear open to those who aren't a part of a big crowd, but they need you. A call comes. A broken heart. A life corrupted by addiction. Somebody off the street. I remember a young kid came into our church in Fullerton, and he was barefoot, didn't have a shirt on. He had on swimming trunks and sand still stuck to the hair of his legs, barefoot. Never been in a church in his life. He stood in the back like this, living on beer and potato chips, he told me later. His folks had kicked him out because he was a young alcoholic, and he stumbled into that building. He'd never seen anything. It happened to be a Sunday night. And he saw these people singing things he had never heard in his life. He saw this guy up there behind that box screaming. And he thought, what on earth is this? It was wonderful meeting him afterwards. He said, you here every day? And I said, well, I'm not. He said, are you at that box every day? And I said, no, I'm usually here on Sunday. How come you're not here tomorrow? Well, I never thought about that. That's a good question. He said, well, hell, can I talk to you tomorrow? And I said, well, hell yeah, come on over. Come on, it's fine. What does it matter? So he came over, he showed up. You know what? Story of that guy. Wound up going to Talbot. He's in ministry today. Marvelous story. Why? Because we cared about it. And you will too. If you keep a heart of compassion, it'll help you a lot with the growing crowd. And we're not through here. Look at this. 32. It doesn't ease up. When evening came after the sun had set, they began bringing to him all, A-L-L, who were ill, and those who were demon-possessed. Can you imagine that? Oh, the whole city had gathered at the door. We're talking crowds. Jesus is in the house. The crowd is there. He's touching lives. He's healing. He's casting out the demons. 34 says he healed many who were ill with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he was not permitting the demons to speak because they knew who he was. He didn't need demons as his evangelists. I love it. You know what I see here? I see faithfulness in meeting needs. Stay faithful to meet the needs. Stay faithful. Stay faithful. There's more to life than the crowds. There's more to life than Sunday stuff. Stay faithful. Stay in touch. Pay attention. Notice those who don't have good eye contact. Pay attention to those who can't keep up. Watch for phoniness. Be alert. Be aware. Forget your success. Stay in touch. Look at people directly. Listen to them. I don't know how many people have said, you know, the amazing thing about you, Chuck, when you talk to me, you look at me. Why is that strange? Every other preacher I've been around, they looked over me. They looked around me. Jay Kessler says a great line. He says, I got my walls filled with pictures of me shaking hands with important people who are looking at somebody else. Hi, Jay, how are you? Don't do that. You just looked at them. He healed them. He knew them. He cared for them. He was faithful to meet their needs. Look at this next scene, 35. And early in the morning, while it was still dark, he's been doing his work through the evening and into the night. And early before it's even sun up, look at what he does. Jesus got up and left the house, went away to a secluded place and was praying there. Oh, he needed solitude to gain perspective. You need solitude. That'll help counteract the success. Be sure you have time alone. Be sure you take time alone. Don't wait for somebody else to give you time alone. You got to find it. And whatever time works for you. For him, it was early morning. And so Simon goes, "Where's Jesus? Where's Jesus? Man, he's already out of his God. He's already, where? We got to go find him." And so look at this. I like this. Simon found him and said, "Everyone is looking for you." See, that was important to Simon. "Man, we got crowds, Jesus. We got everybody looking for us." Look at the answer. Let's go somewhere else, to the towns nearby, so I may preach there also, for that's what I came for. Don't you love it? Simon goes, "Somewhere else? Man, we already got a revival going here in Capernaum. We got people out the wazoo out there. They're everywhere. Look at this." My wife tells me not to use that expression, but I keep forgetting. She said, "Have you ever looked up wazoo?" And I said, "No, and don't tell me what it means." Just people everywhere. In solitude, he gained perspective. This is a page out of Jesus' journal. This is all about you and me when we reach a place where God, by his grace, may say for some unrevealed reason, "All right, you're the man, you're the woman, you're the counselor. You're the one that's going to be the talk of the town. All right, you're the one. What do I do? Can I make it real clear? I make room for compassion. Second, I deliberately cultivate authentic humility." You do that by staying in touch with real people. People who keep telling you the truth. People who aren't impressed. Be sure you have folks around you like that. Make room for compassion. Deliberately cultivate authentic humility. And take time for silence and solitude. You know why? Because it'll help you gain perspective. When you're in silence and solitude before God, it's amazing what he'll show you. Lord, how grateful I am for your timing. You have a wonderful way with it. It's full of mystery and profundity and surprise. And your time for some who sit in this place today, and surely they're sitting there thinking, "It's not going to be me." Your time for them may be sooner, not later. Protect them from the perils. May they handle it well and for your glory. And may they be a Joseph in a nation that's lost its way. May they be a David who served under one who hated him. May they be your woman, your man, in a time like this, in Jesus' name. Everybody said.